Hello, everybody. Hope you're doing marvellously well. We've done a few of these breakdown videos where we've got the multi-tracks, and we've been very, very blessed to talk with Shelley Yackas and Michael Beinhorn, Bradley Cook, and all kinds of amazing people. Dave Jordan, for instance. This has been very, very exciting. This is my chance to actually open a song that I recorded. This song's very important to me. This album was very important to me. The song, of course, is The Fray's first single off their second album, You Found Me. I had worked on the first album of this band, The Fray. I had done How to Save a Life in a more sporadic way. I'd heard the original demos with the A&R guy, Mike Flynn, while we were producing an artist for Epic. And I remember sitting in his Ford F-150 truck in the parking lot of Track Records out in the valley, listening to, I want to say cassette. It was either cassette or really bad quality CD demos of the songs. I mean, like rehearsal demos. And I'd heard this band, and I just remember thinking, these guys were amazing, because it was a piano-driven band, so it had a little bit of a Coldplay kind of thing, because there was a piano driving it. But it also had a rootsy Americana, bit of a Counting Crows kind of thing. And I was like, this hits for me on so many levels. I'm a huge Counting Crows fan, particularly Recovering Satellites was a masterpiece. And this sounded to me like a band that had listened to Recovering Satellites, but also was piano driven. Unbeknownst to me, they'd never even heard Coldplay. They didn't grow up with that. They just had evolved on their own in their own little bubble in Denver. So I had a massive connection to them. I loved the music. I loved the lyrics in particular. And if you listen to How to Save a Life, for instance, you'll know it's just beautiful lyrics about real experiences from somebody who I really, really highly respect, Isaac Slade. And so here I got the chance to do an album from the beginning. And this band, The Fray, were in the process of writing. So the record was quite a long event. It was about 9 months from day one with pre-production and basic recording. We would like work on songs, do pre-production, record basic ideas, right through to the end of the process was 9 months. The first 3 months were in Sausalito, at the plant, if to be American, the plant. And then the remaining 6 months were in Denver at their own studio, which they had built. And we had lots of really great times, and we did it all using an API 1608. That's what we had in the, and we were one of the first people to take delivery of the 1608. A really wonderful console. Can't say enough good things about it. We had a ton of external pre's. We got some other 3124s, which is the 312 mic pre's in a rack of four. We had those. And we did, you know, because of the success of the first album, did have enough of a budget to buy a handful of things and rent a handful of things. And one of those things was to get the same U48, not 47, but U48, that had been used on the first How to Save a Life record. And so we were able to actually buy that from the studio and use it. There was a pair of them, actually, consecutive serial numbers. We have the other one here. I brought my KM53 with us to record guitars. And then we had some newer mics and some obvious things like 57s. It was a really wonderful experience. The most important thing for me was for this record to sound like the record that you were going to hear on the radio by recording it that way. So I have the multi-tracks to play. And for instance, I'm going to play them to you now, unmixed, just the way I recorded them. Okay, so let's check it out.
I found God on the corner of First and Amistad, where the West was all but one, all alone. Smoking his last cigarette, I said, where you been? He said, ask anything. Where were you?
Now, as you can hear, the first thing is obviously like volume discrepancies. You know, to mix the song from where it is now, the first thing, of course, you do is do, you know, volume rounds on the vocal. I turned it up, you know, a couple of dB, you know, on the second half of the verse where the full band came in. But essentially, the sound of the song is the sound of the song. You'll also notice if you look at the WAV files inside of the session, everything is consolidated. There are no edits into it. It's given to a mixer. The session itself is called You Found Me Mix Ready. I put the plap on the end so we know it's for this. But this is the exact session that was sent to Michael. There are no drum samples except for the snare sample, which is actually the live snare itself. So what I would do is at the end of the recording of the drums, I would have the drummer Ben hit the snare and we would take a sample of that snare. And so we would lay that against it. It's like the best way to get like a parallel snare sound, but a parallel snare sound without any bleed of other instruments in it. It's a simple trick and I do it all the time. The snare was my Ludwig Supraphonic. I believe it's like a 71 or 72. It's sitting in the other room. It's been on pretty much every record I've ever made. Every single time that we did a new song, we would try out a multitude of different snares. And what was interesting, no matter what studio we were in, we would do it blind. So I'd be sitting in the control room and Ben would try out these different snares and like boing, boing, you know, and put up another one, boing, boing. And we would always agree on like, that's the best sounding snare. And Ben would be like kind of dejected and be like, that was a Supraphonic. It was like, it would always win. Now, I think this has got a lot to do with the fact that it's sort of the sound of rock and roll. Everybody knows the Ludwig Supraphonic. It is on, between that and a Black Beauty, it's on pretty much every record you've ever heard, especially 60s and 70s albums. Just an absolutely wonderful snare drum. And mine I bought off of eBay maybe 15, 20 years ago, for, in a time when they were worth about $150. It was also rusted and pitted. And even if you look at it now, it's still like really super like pitted after we cleaned it all up and everything. Got new hoops on, all done by Pro Drum on Vine Street in LA. Highly recommend that place. It's just the best. Affordable, amazing job. Been there since the 50s. And so that was the snare we used. Now, one of the biggest things, and I think a really important thing, was how we kept the drums sounding good. Okay, so what I wanna do is I'm gonna solo the drums here and I want to listen. So we're gonna listen to the verse going into the chorus. So here's the verse going into the chorus. So you hear all the drums there. I'm gonna get even more into this. I'm gonna solo all of the elements of the drums. In fact, I'm not even going to use the live sample, even though it's an actual live sample. I'm just gonna use the snare top and snare bottom. And I want you to listen to this. You know, let's put in the rooms. So these are all of the elements, the live elements, and even the overheads. So this is everything centered around, no rack tom, no sample, no kick, just the snare and the other mics picking up. Have a listen to the end of the verse going into the chorus. So you hear that ring? Doesn't change at all. Okay, there is a thing, now this is a great tip as an engineer and a really, really good tool. There is a thing called a drum dial. And as if by magic, look at that. Okay, so the drum dial, I cannot speak any more highly of this. This is the engineer's best friend, let alone a drum tuner. So what we would do is even when we were in Sausalito and we didn't have the ability. We didn't have a full-time drum tech. We did have a guy there that was working, as a utility guy, Jeff, who was amazing, who played keys, additional keys live, played percussion. Jeff Lintermeyer, a great, great guy. And he was, you know, unofficially or officially Ben's drum tech, but he was the everything guy. He helped us with everything. He was phenomenal. But we didn't have Ross Garfield. We didn't have the drum doctor there. We didn't have like the world-class guy that's been making records for 40 years like Ross has, who's amazing. But what we did have was people that were willing to work hard, and this, the drum dial. So why is this so miraculous? Well, what it does is you take the snare drum and you go by every single lug and you measure the tension. And this measures the tension perfectly. So what we would do is we put on a brand new head, we tune it till it sounded amazing, and then we would go around and measure the tension by every single lug moving around and with a Sharpie write down what that was set to. So we did that. Great. We recorded the drums, and then we came to a situation where we were like, we need to replay the part in the chorus. We didn't like the drum part in the chorus. You know, this is on a different day, different week even, maybe even different month, and we redid the drums. We got back to exactly the same snare sound, weeks, potentially a month later, by putting a brand new head on and setting it up exactly the same tensions. And that is why this is a miracle. A miracle worker, a lifesaver, because it keeps, first of all, you can keep the snare perfectly in tune the whole time, not just by ear, but by ear. You tune it by ear to the way you want it, and then you measure it so that you know where it is. You're definitely using your ear to get the sound that you want, to get the evenness, but then you're making a note of what the tension is. This is a really, really good tool. I'm sure we can put some kind of link to it down here to get it. Awesome, awesome apparatus, to say the least. So that was the drum recording. Now, we did the drums for this. This was probably one of the first songs that we, I wouldn't say completed. It was one of the first songs that we tracked most of the stuff on live, but also one of the last songs that we finished. And that was because Isaac didn't have the chorus written yet. He had the music to it, had a rough idea of what he wanted for the melody, but it was an immediate kind of song. It was a song that we loved right from the get-go. Have a listen to this verse melody, and he had the verse lyrics straight away.
I found God on the corner of First and Amistad, where the West was all but one, all alone, smoking his last cigarette. I said, where you been? He said, ask anything.
I mean, it just flows. It's like treacle. Da 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 da. And with that beautiful kind of piano line, that sort of pseudo-classical thing that he's always able to do was just absolutely phenomenal. Now, talking of the vocal is two molts. If you look at it here, this first one is called Vocal Malt 1, and the second one is called Vocal Malt 2. And if you look at my notes, it says lead vocal less compression. So what I did is I had two sets of compression going at all times, and I doubled it up. So I had a 160 going into an 1176 from the U48. So it's the same U48 microphone that was used on How to Save a Life from the studio. It doesn't unfortunately exist, I think, anymore, but Echo Park Studios in Indiana, in Bloomington. It's the same mic that we used on the lead vocal there, but this time I went into my trusty BAE 1073, which is sitting over there. So it went into the 1073 and then went into two molts, a 160 and 1176 and another 160 and another 1176. And the reason why I printed two was just in case he wailed and like it just crushed it. Because every now and then you get your compression set up beautifully, but the singer might, and he was fairly young at the time, might get so overly dynamic that he sings into it too close to the mic and just the compressor goes and chokes it. And I'd had that happen to me a couple of times on different records and sort of always been able to manipulate it and rescue it enough. But I felt like to myself, This is a too important record. They'd already put out an album which had sold 4 million copies worldwide. This was the follow-up album and ended up becoming a number one album. And I think we sold 180 plus thousand in the first week. And it was a big, big deal. And I did not want to mess this up. This is a follow-up album for a band that I was a big fan of. And so I took every precaution. So two different malts. One malt, 160, 1176, compressing everything fairly evenly. And then the second malt was again the same setup, but with the thresholds higher on both compressors. The way I have the compressor sets was 160, about 3-to-1, compressing on both of them, but with different thresholds. And then an 1176 set to 20-to-1 on limit mode, but only getting the peaks, the loudest of loudest peaks, just to control it. So that's my usual setup of vocals. It's the same setup I have here, going 160 into 1176. It's been my setup forever. But thresholds set much, much higher on the second malt, just in case he did wail. Now on this, I don't see anything exceptional that was kind of too aggressively caught. Remember, this is the same vocal. Like if we listen to this note here.
Second all hour.
I love that breakup in his voice. Now, if I take the second malt, we can have a listen to it, try and set it to about the same volume.
Second all hour.
You could argue that's slightly more open. So if Michael, you know, when he's mixing it, felt like, oh, it's choking his compression a little bit, because he uses a lot of parallel compression at the same time on vocals, lots of different ones on the brow rising. If he wanted to do that, he could have taken that other vocal. And that's why I did it. I actually think that this one was probably what he used, the one in the main vocal.
Second all hour.
I think it works beautifully with the harmony.
Second all hour.
And all that grit you hear, that is his vocal. Isaac's a very difficult guy to even attempt to tune. Trying to tune him is like, just get another take. He's got so much grit and personality in his voice that gets exaggerated by the compression and stuff. And I love that. I have nothing against that. That if he doesn't hit the note, punch in and fix it. You know, we did a lot of comps on this and we comped together all the moments we liked. We would sit there and with extensive notes and comp this and get the best performances. And that's what it was about. It was all about performance. Tuning was a last resort. If it didn't hit the note, it was, if there wasn't another take, which there always invariably was another take that was what we wanted. If that happened, then he would go in and re-sing it. There's no sense in tuning a voice like this because you're going to end up getting so many weird artifacts. Now, that isn't to say it doesn't happen. I hear tons of records where I hear the weird artifacts being, you know, manipulated. And that's probably when you're listening to it, you're saying to yourself, that sounds too tuned. I hear people say that all the time. Isaac doesn't have that voice. You know, you just got to redo it. So we did track piano at Sausalito on a Mason and Hamlin. It wasn't the piano that was there. It was actually a piano that we rented. I think Isaac had originally got the idea that he wanted to use this particular piano. From the best of my recollection, I believe they're based in Boston, definitely New England, and they're beautiful pianos. And he loved it so much that he actually bought it. We rented it for a while, then he bought the piano, which meant we then had to ship it back to Denver. So we would do pianos, obviously, originally in Sausalito in the first 3 months. And then for the rest of the album, we would either be fixing or replaying with the same piano, but in a different location. One thing I will say about the Mason and Hamlin, it was an amazing sounding piano, as you can hear here. I'll just play it. Three microphones. It was a pair of 87s. And a 414, and the 414 was in the sound hole. I believe it was the third sound hole. If you've watched any other videos I've done talking about miking pianos, it's very typical of me to put a spaced pair of microphones over the strings, which is quite normal, but then put the C12A or a 414 in that Hull, like the fourth Hull. The reason why I did that was I was making a record years ago at Sunset Sound, and we had blanked off a piano, like completely, you know, covered it in blankets and everything, because we were tracking piano and drums live in the same room. And every day we would come in going, the piano sounds better. It sounds better than it did yesterday. And eventually, when we took off the packing blankets, we found that the microphone had gone from facing over the piano to falling down and actually was in the sound hole and hadn't actually hit the frame, which was incredible. And so, and it did sound better. So it got this sort of metallic thing. You know, it's quite a special technique that I inadvertently found out. I can actually play that mono piano on its own here. It's pretty amazing. If you go to the chorus, and that was a DBX 160 XT. So not a particularly expensive compressor. I think you can pick them up on eBay for about $150, and they're great. The XT or a 160A, I have one down there. Really, relatively inexpensive compressor. You can get them used, like I say, super cheap, Craigslist, eBay. I'm sure they'll go up on eBay now, but basically, like, you know, just get one from Craigslist. They just sound good. And the reason why I kept it on that, and I also use them on kick in a lot of the time as well, is just because that was the compressor we were using when I was at Sunset Sound, when we had that happy accident. So why would I try anything more expensive? It's pretty crushed. It's not like completely destroyed, but you can definitely hear it clamping down. And the left and right on the 87s was actually a stereo compressor. It was a Verimu. I'm a huge Verimu fan. If you want something, you know, and this is hardware and it's expensive, but it's beautiful, Manly Verimu has always been a go-to for me on pianos and on guitars, anything in a stereo. If I want stereo guitars and I'm mixing, it just tames the high end. And as Davey was just reminding me off camera, Isaac, he's right-handed as far as I know, but his left hand is like a ton of bricks hitting a piano. He's very percussive on his left hand, but heck, I've never seen a guy push out a piano out of tune. If there's one, a guy that can do it, it's him. And we were constantly keeping these pianos in tune. But the stereo imagery on this piano is fantastic. Mason and Hamlin, beautiful piano. The mono just adds some solidity to it. If I take it out and drop it in, you'll hear. And I really, really prided myself on really capturing a great piano performance. Like, it's not heavily edited. It's all about performance. It's all about like replaying, getting it right. If there was any editing, any like moving of any note whatsoever, I listened to it 1,000 times to make sure there was no like obvious crossfade, clicks, pops. This song is a piano vocal song with a band. So that piano better be feel good, you know, drive the song and be a beautiful enough recording that whoever's mixing it can push the piano up because it's a piano vocal song. So a lot of care and attention. Now, we did bring in Zach Ray. And Zach Ray did some keyboard overdubs, and one of those is this. Everything we did at Zach, we did at Glenwood Place. Glenwood Place is a beautiful studio run by Kit. I think she's still there, and she runs the studio beautifully. Zach just brought in a ton of keyboards, and we had fun doing live keyboards. So, like, if it was a synth or whatever, it would be going through an amp. We did some great, great work. So Zach did some incredible work. And it just exaggerates that little movement. It's really beautiful. And it's a live performance. There's no MIDI, there's no this, there's no that. That's a real guy playing. So with that comes a little bit of breathing, but it's beautiful. I mean, if you want to quote unquote look at this for a second, just to make my point, here is a downbeat and here's Zach. It's behind, but it gives it a little bit of a groove. So again, don't be afraid to use real human beings and use their performances. It almost gives it like a little bit of a delay, a little bit of extra movement that you didn't know was there. Yeah.
I found God on the corner of First and Amistad.
Cool. So let's go back to the drums. We've talked a bit about the vocals. Compression, no EQ applied whatsoever on the vocals going down. That is exactly like it is. Piano, I may have done a little bit of high passing, but probably not. We kept things pretty fat. I think from a perspective of Michael mixing it, he probably was high passing, you know, here and there, cleaning up some of the low mids. I would expect that. We were all about printing big, fat tones as analog as we possibly could make them. So going into the kick in was a D112. And with the D112, I'll do the most amount of EQ and compression. This is probably, of all the mics on the drum kit, the one that had the most amount of work. So I used the kick in for my snap and, you know, maybe a bit of body. So this will have had, with the Neve EQ, because this was tracked originally at Sausalito, the drums, with the Neve EQ, I would have booted some 60, I would have pulled out some low mids and boosted probably a little bit of 2 to 3K area. It's super aggressive, but it's just one component. Then the kick out would have been, we originally started off with a FET 47, so a FET 47 on the outside head. But then here's the secret, it's the kick sub. So this was an NS10, I think it was a homemade NS10, picking up. What's interesting, you see when he plays it lighter and he doesn't, so have a listen to this. You hear the low end blowing up on this one hit. It's because he's not hitting it as hard and he's also not laying his kick pedal into the head. So where he does this and it stops on the head, it gives us good low end. Where he goes, where he does this thing, where he lets it bounce back, there's more low end. It's a great lesson in, like, if you want to get as much low end as you want out of a kick drum, let the beater bounce back naturally. Have a listen to this. That one there. That second one just rings. And if you want to look at it, not that I say that we should be looking at things, but look at the low end on that. And I think for some songs, you know, I would go back in and put the sub across it, you know, so you can manipulate it in the way you want. But yeah, you can firmly see just like how much that sings out because he just tapped it. And it happens every time he plays those short, lightly played kicks. So those are the three elements that make up the kick drum. You really feel that in this room on the Genelex. Now the snare top was nothing unusual, it was a 57 top and bottom. And then I did two things. I took the exact sample of it itself. If you look at it, talk about phase coherent, look at that. That is a sample of the snare being played in the room. It's about as phase coherent as you can imagine. So that just reinforces the sound. And it's buried underneath. I've got it minus 21. That's what I would have given Michael. And then the snare sample that I've added here, you hear it's exactly the same ring. That's because it's the same snare again, and all I did was annihilate it with compression. So once again, look at it. Look at how phase coherent that is. It's insanely phase coherent because it's the same snare. There's no sample in here of a different snare. So all the things that I'm adding are just reinforcing the snare, giving, giving the mixer more mix options. There's no different sample going cling or crack or boosh or something like that. It's just the snare. I wanted to present this as a sound of the band playing, of the drums playing in the room. I didn't want this to come across as like this, like, you know, heavily manipulated drum sound. I wanted this to be natural. And then the snare room is again the same snare in the room. Hats, you know how I do hats, Dave Jordan technique, a 57 and a pencil condenser taped together. And those came up on two channels and then they were bussed together. The rack tom in this time was frankly a 421. Floor tom, same thing. Ride cymbal. I would either go a 57 or a Roya 121. It really depends on what I wanted. I don't know if there is any ride in this. Yep, here it is. He's just crashing on it like a crash cymbal. Three overheads. I believe these were 67s. We were blessed to have really nice mics that we rented. And when we were in Sausalito, they had them. So three 67s, one in the center and left and right. And the most important thing was to make sure they were phase coherent. So if you see all these three here, they're all hearing the snare at the same time. So whatever I choose to do with them, if I want to push them up in the mix, they're going to be even. They're not going to make the snare feel like it's coming out the sides. I've had that happen a few times before where people send me mixes and the overheads are out of phase with the snare. So the way I get them in phase is I measured them to the snare. Right, the mono room is a couple. Super, super compressed deliberately. What I did is I used a distressor. Here's the second one. And I had the attack times deliberately set on those just to let the attack through. And I found that when I was like working with the drums, I felt like I had a lot of like boof and like I had loads of body and stuff, but I was lacking a bit of extra attack. So I made these room mics, these two mono ones, be, you know, like more aggressive and snappy. The stereo rooms, I had a high stereo room mic. And those are over the kit, up high, as far back as I could get in Sausalito, because it wasn't a very big room. It's the room where they did Songs in the Key of Life, it's where Rumors was done, but it's not a particularly big room. So those are high up, pointing at the snare in phase. So they are exactly the same distance away. So when you see where the snare hits here, the phase is consistent. So whatever I choose to do, it doesn't, again, make the snare feel like it's coming out of the left or the right. The low room mics that had a parquet floor, is a really nice floor. So those mics are a pair of CMV 563s, which is a pair of my favorite mics. And the CMV 563s, they're like the lollipop shape, are pointed at the floor. So this is listening to the floor, again, measured equally to the snare. I would use a little tiny bit of tape underneath the cymbals and a little bit of paper towel, like kitchen towel, whatever you want to call it, just taped under the cymbals so that, just to kind of take the edge off the cymbals so that the room mics weren't just cymbals. You see, it's pretty balanced there. I mean, obviously, I have a great relationship with Ben. He's a drummer I could communicate with well. We'd done some records together. We'd obviously done, worked on, I did the drums of How to Save a Life, the song, in my personal studio with very limited equipment. We can listen to that another time. And the we'd already had a great working relationship, so I was very cognizant to talk to him about how heavy he was playing the cymbals, but we took the edge off a little bit, and he was aware that I was doing that. But if you listen to these room mics, he's pretty balanced. Those are the high ones as well, so they're actually favoring the cymbals. If I put both the room mics in together, you'll hear just how even he's playing. Great excitement from the cymbals, great excitement, but really good kick and snare balance. I mean, he's a great drummer. So that was a huge part of it. No compression, no EQ going on that. There was no compression on EQ on anything on the drums except for the kick in. I might occasionally use a little bit of 1176 on the snare top, but that is it. Those were the only things getting any kind of compression and EQ going down. Everything else was just good, even performances. Okay, we've done the vocal, we've listened to the piano and the drums. I think what, and of course, Zach's keyboard overdub there. There's a tack piano that Zach added in the second verse. And you can tell I used the distressor on that and I was deliberately letting the attack go through because I wanted it to cut over the top. If you throw in all the piano and Zach's other stuff, you'll hear what it does. I wonder if anybody here knows what I was going for. I really love that Get Carter, the music to Get Carter. Go back and listen to that. The Michael Caine movie from the late 60s, early 70s, I forgot what year. And you'll see what I mean. It's that kind of creepy, kind of like makes you think, I don't know, Ibcrest file, Odessa file, you know, all of that period is just amazing. I personally had a fascination with the Moog Opus, and this is Dave. And Dave had a whole bunch of keyboards. There's something about the Moog Opus, or the Moog Opus, depending on how you want to pronounce it, which is one of the most misunderstood kind of synth. It came out at a period when everybody was moving digital or bringing up, you know, just before FM Synthesis and DX7s, but all of these huge, like, Jupiter 8s, which were incredible, were coming out. And this kind of got ignored because it was kind of a little weedy. So we felt like this song doesn't need a massive string arrangement. So if it's going to have strings, let's make it sound synthetic. And that's what we did here. And it just sounds beautiful against this vocal. Lost and insecure. Great. Then we have Joe, who's a great rhythm guitar player, playing, this was his J45. Lost in dance cure. You found me lying on the floor. And what's great about Joe's rhythm there is he's almost playing like a shaker. And it just keeps the momentum going. Lost in dance cure. There's a little imperfection there, I love it. Where were you, just a little late? Little wrongness. Okay. I don't think you can talk about this song though, as brilliant as it is, as amazing as the songwriting is, as amazing as the lyrics are, and I know they touched a lot of people. You can't talk about this song without talking about Dave's guitar part. So, let's have a listen to Dave's guitar part. So in Sausalito, they had like a little overdub room, which was like slate, like a stone room. We got Dave's, he had just bought it as 65 Deluxe. He and I had talked before the making of the record on what kind of wish list of gear. And I'd said to him, the 65 Deluxe, possibly the most recorded session guitar amp, you know, with many, many others, get into a huge debate, but a hugely, hugely recorded amp. So we got this Deluxe 65. I mic'd it front and back with a 57 front and back, Dave Jordan technique, flipped the polarity of the back mic, and that was how I mic'd the amp. Now, I also took the room mics from the drums and opened the door up from the overdub room so you hear this. What's making it even bigger still was the Deluxe 65, and he had a Holy Grail. That's the Holy Grail pedal by Electroharmonix. So that's the reverb that you hear. So it's like exaggerated. It's a guitar amp in a slate room, close mic with an Electroharmonix Holy Grail going into a live room, and it's cranked. The 65 is like cranked. And all of those drum room mics are going as well. And so we get this guitar sound. The guitar was a Fender Deluxe. So it was a Telecaster Deluxe. He had it on a humbucker, obviously, and he was just doing this. As we say, Johnny Greenwooding it, just like. And what's wonderful about this is like the vocals, the lead vocal and the choruses were finished after all of the basic tracking. We had the song tracked. I mean, I'm looking at this now thinking to myself, this is a huge song. This was like a worldwide number one hit. It was huge everywhere. And how many tracks are there? But if you discount the samples, we haven't got to bass yet. We'll get to that last. I mean, what is it? 30 tracks, 40 tracks maximum. I mean, it's pretty limited. And we did do overdubs and stuff like that, you know, but they're pretty minimal and everything made sense. There was a lot of discussion, a lot of thought put into this. Here's Dave's guitar in the verse. So good. And again, as Dave Jordan and Jack Douglas taught me, all of the effects are printed from the amp. Deluxe again, Fender Telecaster again, but all of the effects, the delays and everything, are printed from the amp. There's no additional stuff done by me, no engineer production stuff. This is discussion with Dave getting the guitar sound. We had a blast doing this. Have a listen. I mean, how beautiful is that? Brings tears to my eyes. It's just an amazing line. He has such a great ear for melody, and being a little obtuse, a little kind of like getting in there and pushing against things, just a little, you know, as sweet as Dave is, a little punk rocky kind of aesthetic. He was always able to like add something to it that not many guitar players I work with are able to do. Dave Jordan was saying this to the other day. He's like, he loves session players, of course. He's like, but bands always give him a little wrongness. He likes the band. I know with Dave, he prided himself for many, many years of never firing a musician and never replacing a musician on an album. I think I know one story where they retracked the drums on an album, which they ended up getting rid of the drummer and bringing in a different drummer, a new drummer because of it. But other than that, he prided himself, and I think this is a thing as a producer and an engineer, to get performances out of your musicians as much as you can. So there's some great rakes here in the bridge. I love that, and then the end of it. And these guitar sounds were shaped. They were shaped. I had the API, you know, graphic, and I would just EQ it the way I wanted to hear it inside of the mix. So. Left me no messages. What a great guitar. Definitely wiped off the top, just made it fit. And then Zach's additional piano he added here. So, no loops were harmed in the making of this recording. That is actually, that's the recording. So what we did is I took the mono and I created a loop out of one of Ben's drum parts. So those are all, you see the room mics, you've got the high and the low room mics, and then the two mono room mics, and that's what that is. And then I had the chamber available, so I thought I'd try it with the chamber. So that's just like super squashed. Well, were you? But in my rough, I didn't have it in. Lying on the floor. I'd have to go back to the final mix that Michael did to see what they ended up doing with it. All right, last but no means least, Mr. Dan Rothschild. Why am I getting it to it last? Because we did redo the bass. We had tracked the bass with their touring bass player, and he had done an admirable job, but it sounded a little stiff. It didn't have, sometimes when you're working on a song and you maybe, you know, tracked a lot of it and then adding parts and coming back to it, sometimes, you know, something might suffer. Something might suffer, and the bass was very, like, perfectly played by the original bass player, the touring bass player. He did a really wonderful job. He played really well, played super tight, but he didn't have quite the fire and passion of a song that's like, you found me, you know, lost and insecure. There's passion in it. The lyrics are very, very close to Isaac's heart. They mean something to him. And we just felt like it was near the end of the record, and Dan Rothschild is a very good old friend of mine. He lives behind me, strangely enough, coincidentally. And if you know about his pedigree, he played bass with Fiona Apple. He's he's that he's that bass line. He's, if it makes you happy, he's that bass line, which is also phenomenal. He's got a signature to him. But more importantly, he's insanely talented. He's one of the best ears of any musician I know. He could just chart, like Zach as well, Zach Ray, can chart a song out while having a conversation. You could be talking to him and the song's playing in the background and both of them will go in and play it. They're both like ridiculously next level talented. And if you listen to Dan, the way he plays, his lines are super interesting, sometimes super obvious the way that they should be, but never, ever, ever boring. And he is able, because he plays an old beaten up P bass that he's had forever, he's able to bring, and the guy is a producer in his own right. He produced Better Than Ezra's first and biggest selling album in his bedroom. It sold like 2 million copies and he produced it in his bedroom. So this guy brings everything. Great vocals, percussion, he's the percussionist on this as well, can play percussion. He's a producer in his own right, like I was saying, a songwriter, a singer, and he just brought some fire to it. So have a listen. Now, it might sound dumb and simple, but just that brings, rather than going da, 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 he's doing and it's just that approach. Subtle things, but subtle things like that can make a huge difference. Can you hear what we did? He's playing fingers in the verse. Picks up the pick. See that? You found me. He's like, he's catching little subtle parts of the melody.
Surrounded, why'd you have to wait? Where were you? Just a little late. You found me.
I love that. Dun, dun, dun.
You found me.
It's just like, these things are, are they difficult to play? Not necessarily difficult, it's the thought process that goes into it. It's like when you listen to Jeff Beck. Any guitar player worth his salt is a fan of Jeff Beck. We're all fans of Jeff Beck. Not necessarily because he's playing something that might be the most technical thing. He does play some really difficult things. Some of his bends are insane. It's more like, oh, I never would have thought of that. That's what I like about Dan Roughchild.
You found me.
I think something that was really, really important and predates a couple of other songs that do this was to make the verses insanely different. Like, here's the first verse. So the groove is a bit more of it. Now listen to the second verse.
In the end, everyone ends up alone, losing her, the only...
I mean, if I played you those two as separates, you'd think they're two different songs. It's like, this is what makes production and engineering and recording and making music. This is what I'm always looking for. I'm looking for this. I'm looking for bands to bring it and try new ideas and try something. There's not like, there's so much hurry up. You know, what is the phrase that you hear? You hear it on every other frickin' channel and person. Don't bore us, get to the chorus. You know what? How about just don't bore us at all? How about make the song interesting the whole time? And that is what I think really these guys did a great job on. What you think is a guitar is actually a clavinet. And that's Dave as well. Dave really is like a little mini Johnny Greenwood. He plays, you know, guitar and keys and stuff. We had Zach come down and do a couple of things. That was great. But that's Dave. And so we tried it on guitar, but we decided to go on the clavinet. So you throw in the tap piano. It just gave a whole different idea. Remember the other day when we were listening to Blue Oyster Cult and it had that clavinet playing against the guitar, which gives it a different kind of spongy feeling? Same thing there. Absolutely fantastic. Great. Well, I hope you enjoyed this. To me, it's all about the song, obviously, and you hear it all the time, the song, the Quincy Jones quote, we hear it all the time. But more importantly about that, it's about the inventiveness and the creativity, the fact that each one of these sections of the song has a completely different way and a different approach. The other thing that we learned is like, the drum dial was a miraculous thing for us because we were able to keep the kit in tune at all times and punch in and fix areas at different times. Also, you know, Dan came in and tracked that bass at the end and was able to pick up the vocal melody and everything. We brought him in the, like literally the last few days of the record, and he came in and replayed most of the album in a day because he brought a freshness of approach and an energy. Fingerstyle in verses, pick in choruses, get the best of both worlds. Don't be, you know, don't be sort of held back by going, oh, I'm a purist, I only play with my fingers. No, but what's best for the song? This kind of recording is what excites me, being able to make records like this and working with artists who were, you know, Ben may have been 21 or 22 when we did this record. On the first record, he was 19. These guys were super young and they were hungry. They had something to say. Isaac's lyrics always come from an incredibly personal place. This is a song that I cannot tell you how important it was. And, you know, everything was like a perfect storm for me. And it was a blessing that this came out and the song was such a big hit because we put so much love and time and attention into it. And one of the things we can say is like, this was in a Pro Tools world. So we could have had like 150 tracks if we wanted, and we don't. We have 30 or 40, and they're essentially like very, very specifically chosen tracks because I wanted a mixer to pull this up on a console and know what the song was about. Thank you ever so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed that. Have a marvelous time recording and mixing. Please leave a bunch of comments and questions below because I know the answers. I recorded this song. Have a marvelous time recording and mixing.